Fellow Marks, and welcome to The Mark Remark, the only mainstream wrestling series that doesn't rely entirely on nostalgic references to the days when we used to be significantly more popular. And hey, when you're done watching this show, why don't you go check out my other web series, Yu-Gi-Oh! The Abridged Series, circa YouTube 2006. It's only got like a million Facebook fans and stuff. Screw the rules, I have money and all that. My name's Martin, and I'm just as confused as you are that the WWE chose to hire a cheesy voiceover guy for the recap of last week's WWE shenanigans.
Previously on Monday Night Raw.
Imagine tuning into the Super Bowl and hearing the words, "Previously on Football." Or if you got to the end of a baseball game and you heard the theme music from EastEnders kick in. Last week saw a great deal of controversy behind the scenes of Monday Night Raw, as former NXT and Cruiserweight champion Neville is heavily rumored to have walked out and quit the company. The WWE was, as always, expedient and communicative with its fanbase to address these rumors in as direct a way as possible.
Rumors. Who said anything about rumors?
That's right, despite whatever the hell I was just talking about, and honestly, who even remembers anymore, the most important thing to note about last week's Raw was the reunion of popular wrestling faction The Shield. Named as such due to it being Vince McMahon's equivalent of Captain America's weapon of choice, which he throws at bad ratings whenever they rear their ugly heads.
Just like days of old!
It was like 3 bloody years ago, which I suppose in the short-term memory-riddled world of wrestling may as well be the dawn of man.
There are no more rumors!
Trust me, Corey, it's pro wrestling. We got plenty of rumors left. In case you're wondering what caused The Shield to reunite after 3 long years of being broken up into singles wrestlers, it all started when The Miz recruited Bo Dallas and Curtis Axel into his heel stable of, wait, stop, where are you going? No, I promise this feud is way more interesting than it sounds, come back! Speaking of things that are liable to make you turn around and leave, this week Raw comes to us live from Portland, Oregon. And the entrance area is surrounded by the entire 205 Live roster. Oh, I'm sorry, that's actually just a large number of inanimate objects that are mostly used as set dressing. Gentrified Manfred Mann Kurt Angle comes out and describes things for people who missed the heavily narrated video package just mere seconds earlier.
Well, I think it's safe to say that The Shield are back together.
And yet it's still not safe to say the word wrestler without severe repercussions. But it's a good thing Kurt's here to reiterate the fact that The Shield are back together, because otherwise, who else would have talked over The Shield's entrance and almost entirely deflated their big moment returning in their original Shield getup?
But that's this Sunday. I want to focus on tonight.
I mean, it's not like they could have just opened the episode with The Shield coming out. That's just silly. It turns out they're called The Shield because of how badly you'll want to shield your eyes from Kurt Angle's cringy introduction. The Shield makes their grand entrance through the crowd just like in ye olden days of old, while Booker T is distracted by his new pet dog Portland that he's got hidden under the announce table.
Making their way to the WWE Universe!
Portland's getting a treat, guys.
Booker T reflects on the unique qualities that The Shield brings to the table.
You know, when I saw that goal, I knew we were in a different era watching, you know, The Shield pretty much take over here like so many have in the past.
So they were completely different in the sense that they were doing what loads of other people have done before. Gotcha. Roman Reigns, Dean Ambrose, and Seth's surroundings roll Kurt Angle as part of their classic intimidation tactics. And then in a shocking twist, it turns out tonight's episode of Raw was filmed entirely within Kurt Angle's body.
And The Shield surrounding the ring inside the general manager, Kurt Angle.
The wrestling is coming from inside the Olympic hero. Roman Reigns does his best to hide how grateful he is to go back to doing paint-by-numbers Shield promos so that he can avoid taking most of the blame for his mid-tier mic skills, and makes an emphatic statement.
Because when the hounds come down to this ring, you got 2 choices.
Stuffing or potatoes. They run a strict kitchen. Seth Phrasings misrolls his next line.
Take it easy, big dong.
You know, I usually like a good big dong on an episode of Raw, but that's usually when it precedes the arrival of The Undertaker. or when it's a penis. Seth recountings rolls the brief history of the Shield leading up to today. And hilariously, Roman Reigns reacts to it like a wide-eyed little kid who was just now hearing the story.
When we were in this ring together, we dominated!
And then one day, that all went away.
Dean Ambrose gets us hyped for the Shield's upcoming match at Tables, Ladders, and Chair, which will see them taking on The Miz, Sheamus and Cesaro, and Braun Strowman, while the song If I Could Turn Back Time plays on a constant loop. Professional wrestler and occasional stand-in for Rocket Raccoon Dean Ambrose lunatic fringes all over the dang place.
There is no force of nature on this earth as powerful as the Shield!
Yes, no force of nature can hope to stand up to them. In fact, one could easily use the Shield as definitive proof that climate change is a real thing. For example, in 2014, a chunk of the Shield the size of New Mexico broke off and proceeded to generate more heat in the 2015 Royal Rumble than had been scientifically documented in the last four decades. No force of nature indeed. The wrestling stable equivalent of Geostorm is quickly forced to put their money where their mouth is as their opponents this Sunday come out to face off with them, causing Kurt Angle to throw an Olympic sized tantrum when he realizes he didn't get to talk over their entrance like he did with the Shield.
The Intercontinental Champion is...
Hold on a second!
Good thing nobody ever interrupted one of Kurt Angle's entrances, or we may never have gotten Jason Jordan. Later in the night, Alicia Fox demonstrates why it's a bad idea to attack an official near a referee spawning point.
You don't look like my dad! You don't look like my mom!
You don't want to be near a referee spawning point near mating season. It gets rather messy. Also very loud, given that they all chastise each other if certain sexual positions go on for too long, and they start aggressively counting to five to release the hold. The official theme for this Sunday's TLC pay-per-view is Legendary, a song all about the quest to learn the size of Batista's dick. Backstage, without his friend Bo Dallas accompanying him, Curtis Axel's world is thrown into a state of disarray, causing him to start talking like Shrek and to believe that Braun Strowman is his mother.
My man!
Curtis Axel believes that he deserves to be the fifth man picked to go up against the Shield in their match at TLC. And to prove it, he offers to go find Roman Reigns right now and beat him up. Let this be a lesson to all of you. If you've ever wanted to prove that you're good enough for any job, just tell them that you're willing to go kick the crap out of Roman Reigns. You'll be hired almost on the spot. Hello, yes, I'm here for the librarian job.
Do you know anything about the Dewey Decimal System?
No, but I'd love to punch Roman Reigns in the face.
Sorted.
Last week, the never-ending Bray Wyatt-Finn Balor feud turned into a fight between a Snapchat filter and the meh emoji. And Sister Abigail's voice filter somehow managed to be more subdued, but also simultaneously infinitely more obnoxious.
And I promised him that I would always be there
by his side.
Yes, it turns out that this match on the Tables, Ladders, and Cher pay-per-view will feature Bray Wyatt performing a cover of Cher's notoriously auto-tuned Believe.
I'm worse than anything your world has ever dreamed of.
Finally, Bray says something that I can both understand and agree with. Remember back in 2015 where Bray basically cut promos on nothing for 8 weeks, leading to his match with The Undertaker, and it was oddly compelling? This is a feud between two wrestlers cutting promos as four completely different characters between them, and it only manages to be oddly off-putting. This week, Finn Balor comes out to address his really cool and awesome fan club, which is something only really cool and awesome people have, regarding the veiled threats Bray has been making. I mean, they were specific threats, but he made them while wearing a veil.
And he has developed quite the relationship with the WWE Universe, and that, Corey, is what really has got under the skin of Bray Wyatt as of late.
Oh, so that's what they've been feuding about? It's been like 2 months, and I swear I didn't understand what it was all about until just now.
Well, basically, Finn has succeeded where Bray has failed up to this point.
Yeah, you're gonna have to be more specific about the whole where Bray has failed thing, because that covers a lot of ground. Booker T's mind is so far out there, he may as well be doing commentary with Max Moon.
He better watch his back, because we're talking about Bray Wyatt, guys, since making his debut. It's been unstoppable.
In that he hasn't been able to stop losing? In that he hasn't been able to stop rambling incoherently to himself in lieu of an actual promo? This is like saying the Titanic's maiden voyage was a resounding success, which in Booker T's world may very well be the case. I mean, sure, it sank and a multitude of people died horribly, but hey, biggest movie box office of all time, am I right? Finn Balor's internal processing unit struggles to cope with minor character development.
You see, when I was a kid, I used to read about the Celtic Festival of Samhain.
Woo! Yeah, the Celtic Festival of Samhain! Woo! Irish mythology! Yeah, I definitely came to a wrestling show to hear about this! Woo! Finn Balor does what any strong babyface would do when confronted with Bray's brand of bollocks, which is to scoff at Bray Wyatt's trickery and tell him to get rid of all the smoke and mirrors and face him like a... Oh, no, wait. Finn just plays right into it and is actually very concerned about Bray's Snapchat antics.
Now, I used to think that these were just stories, but then after seeing Sister Abigail, after feeling her presence, I realized that these weren't just stories, but they were real.
You know, Finn, there's a really easy way to get out of this match, because please, God, get out of this match. Just remind WWE that they have a strict policy on not allowing women to wrestle men, and you'll be off scot-free. Finn Balor reveals his new variation on the Demon King persona. Pump King, the King of Ghosts. Rumor has it that when he's promoted from 205 Live, Jack Gallagher will unite with Pumpkin Finn to create the tag team of the Smashing Pumpkins, with a debuting Billy Corgan as their manager. I mean, he's not busy right now, is he? What's he doing? What's he doing? Michael Cole stops himself from saying how he really feels about Curtis Axel while the Shield debate the size of Batista's dick.
And there's...
The new episode of popular sitcom That's Our Miz is a barrel of laughs.
I believe the Axeman may be single-handedly destroying the Shield. I'm sorry, what?
Maybe. He said he wanted to beat up Roman Reigns, so I told him to go do it.
Mickey James narrowly avoids casually declaring that winning a wrestling belt would mean more to her than the birth of her son.
I have a 3-year-old little boy at home waiting for me. And when I tell you that he is the light of my life, he is my everything. It's the greatest feeling in the world. But you know what would be... one of the greatest feelings in my entire career.
Miz finds Curtis Axel hanging upside down like one of the enemy NPCs from an Arkham game, surrounded by referees who are confused that their strategy of saying, no, no, don't do that, to gravity, isn't getting them anywhere. Later in the night, Roman Reigns and Braun Strowman go one-on-one in a steel cage. But just in case the steel cage doesn't do its job, gentle man-bear pig Kurt Angle declares that everyone is banned from ringside, guaranteeing that there can't possibly be any interference. The Shield and the Miztourage interfere in the match almost immediately, with zero repercussions from Jennifer Manatarm's Kurt Angle. But this is only because he was busy at the local Build-A-Bear, letting his son Jason Jordan pick up a My Little Pony the Movie brand stuffed toy and wasn't around to enforce anything. Roman loses the match after Kane out of nowhere interrupts it in order to promote his bid for election as mayor of Knox County. After being informed by his campaign manager that voters don't like the fact that he's a horrific demon from the Seventh Circle of Hell, but they do like when he tombstones the mild smugness out of Roman Reigns. Burning it on down over to SmackDown Live, and Tom Phillips had to be replaced on commentary by Michael Cole due to his hiding a whoopee cushion on Kevin Dunn's favorite chair, forcing his parents to ground him for 2 weeks. The Fashion Files regrettably devolves into a reference-heavy series of forced humor and inside jokes. And if you like that sort of thing, you'll love my other web series, Yu-Gi-Oh! The Abridged Series, circa YouTube 2006. There are like 77 episodes to watch now, Brooklyn Rage and other such malarkey. Baron Corbin is so enraged at being confronted with a Lucha Libre wrestler that he forgets what an open challenge actually is.
Does everybody in here want to see me give Sin Cara an opportunity and make this a United States Open Challenge match?
Yes, an open challenge. As in, when you open your mouth and find yourself challenged to recall that an open challenge means it's open to everyone and not just the one dude. This week, Sin Cara is Spanish for wins via countout. Chad Gable is doing just fine without Jason Jordan. Really, he's moved on. He's not looking back. He's not crying in his pillow before bedtime, trying to comfort himself over the loss of his tag partner. He's not trying to fill the Jason Jordan-shaped hole in his life with legendary mid-carder Shelton Benjamin. He's not driving past Jason Jordan's house at 2 a.m. with his car window rolled down, one arm outstretched toward Jason Jordan's bedroom window in the faint hope that he can tag his partner back into his life. No, Chad is ready, willing, and able to move on. And how can he not when he's given great material like this to work with?
Because I feel good.
Yeah, tell him how you feel.
I feel better than good. I feel like,
He's gonna be just fine. The WWE accidentally airs a commercial for this year's Not Scary Farm.
The darkness of destruction.
Oh no, my mistake. It's their newest attempt at repackaging former Wyatt family members Luke Harper and Eric Rowan. Clearly an homage to the shittest Silent Hill monster of all time, the Boogeyman. No, not that one. There's the lame thing. Jinder Mahal comes out and brags about his recent trip to India.
Nothing but royal treatment for the Maharaja. Five-star hotel, the finest restaurants.
And that right there is the only time in known existence that Jinder Mahal and five stars will ever be associated with one another. Well, that's your lot for this time, I'm afraid. There should be a new episode real soon unless someone comes down with a horrific case of meningitis. In which case, I'll just replace myself with Kurt Angle. Another balding guy who just stares off into space and says things. I mean, you'll barely notice. Catch you next time, and toodle pip.